Survive, you're my king from Boston. Survive, I'm your king from Boston. Yo, what's going on, everybody? It is Straight Outta Boston here, aka the King of Boston, and today we are back for episode 10 of the NCAA Football 14 Dynasty on my channel, Georgia State, of course. That introduction was a little awkward anyway, so we're getting into some recruiting here, and I'm doing it a little bit different this week. I'm just showing some key highlights instead of speeding it all up. So we were putting points into James Banks, a running back that I recently added to our board in hopes of possibly landing him. I want to land one or two running backs, and the two guys that I had in mind have not slipped. Well, they slipped a little bit on our board, so hopefully we can try to get them. And if not, he's kind of a backup option at this point. You saw we're scheduling visits there, and we're going to upgrade our defensive coordinator, Jesse Minter, end up giving him road close level 2. And we're going to move over to offensive coordinator Jeff Jagosinski and give him ball security level 3. Hopefully both of those should help us out in the future. And you're going to see here we're going up against UL Monroe in a very tough game, a battle of 5-2 teams in the conference. The leader, or the winner of this game, will take the overall lead in the conference standing. So this is a very important game for both squads. Now, a lot of you guys have been questioning if I should turn the difficulty up yet or not. Well, this isn't Heisman difficulty, but we are going to be implementing some sliders next week, I believe, or the week after, I should say. So those will hopefully up the difficulty a little bit, because yeah, I agree, Georgia State probably shouldn't be 5-2 at this point, but it is what it is. Nothing we can do about it right now, so look for those soon. And hopefully those who are a little bit, I guess, I don't know what the word would be, but a little bit razzled or whatever by the fact that we're 5-2, hopefully we can satisfy you guys in the near future. So when I get into this gameplay, you can see Colton Browning is their impact player. He's actually not pictured there, but you can see He had an okay game last week. He is the leader of this 5-2 UL Monroe squad, and he is really good, man. He is kind of like a little Tim Tebow. He's fast. He's a lefty, number 15. He can run. He can throw a little bit. Definitely more of a runner, but you can see here at 2nd and 7, UL Monroe was driving early on. It's going to be a handoff to Jarius Edwards right there, and Edwards is going to pick up 3rd. He's going to pick up about 6 yards there, so that's going to set up a 3rd and 1. On 3rd and 1, we're setting the blitz. We call it nicely, and we're going to take down Edwards in the backfield for a loss of 2 yards. So that would set up a 4th down. They would punt it away here. You can see the punt. Hopefully we can get a good return. We're going to be sending Kelly back. No, it's a fake by them, and they end up not picking up the 1st down. They lose a couple yards. So we get the ball back in very nice field position here, 2nd and 12. McLean drops back. He gets the start once again this week. Albert Wilson picks up 21 yards on the crawl route right there. Effective play right there. And here we go. A little triple option action, triple read option. McLean is going to keep it, picks up a block, and is going to pick up a nice first down right there, 9 yards total on the gain. So we're on the continue the drive. Another triple read option. McLean pitches it to Paris Lee at the last moment, and Lee is going to make his way inside the 10-yard line for the first down. 11-yard gain on the play. First and goal for the Panthers. Now 2nd and goal. Another play. This is going to be a keeper by McLean once again, who will barrel his way up to the 1-yard line. That would set up a 3rd and goal. Nice little 3-yard rush right there for Ben McLean. And then here we go one more time. A straight handoff to Paris Lee, and Lee will take this one into the end zone for the 1-yard touchdown. So a lot of read option on that drive right there. We really wanted to control the ball early on, and I know some people don't like when I run the read option too much, but to me it's just the same as doing any effective pass route, like a corner route or a curl or a slant or an in or an out, or really a lot of things that work in this game. But we force a fumble right there on the ensuing drive, and this looks like a huge momentum changer, but they're going to review it. Let's take a look at the replay right here. It appears that the UL Monroe wide receiver was clearly down, and this was just a mistaken call by the referees, but this will probably be overturned in the booth. We'll see what happens. Maybe a little bit closer than we thought, but referee comes back out, and he's going to rule that this one will be reviewed. It will be reversed, and this will be a first down for UL Monroe. So really come on 1st and 10. Browning hands it off. Nope, it's a play action. Fires it on the flat to his tight end, it looks like, and he will pick up 9 yards on the play. That's going to be a 2nd and 1. Now on 2nd and 1, Colton Browning once again. It's going to be a read option. He keeps it. He takes it to the right side, and here he can showcase some of his speed down the sideline. McClendon gets there, as does the person behind him. That's going to be a 30-yard pickup, though, for UL Monroe. So 2nd and 5 here. Browning drops back. He stays in the pocket, finds it to Steed right there for the first down, and that will be a new set of downs for UL Monroe, who continues their drive. 2nd and 9. Browning keeps it once again, and he will make his way into the end zone for the touchdown, the first score of the day for UL Monroe, and they are on the board, an extra point away from tying this game up. So a nice, impressive drive. Good job by Colton Browning, a guy that I talked about before in the episode. Like, he's really coming back big right here. So Ben McLean, first and 10, scrambles to his right, looking, takes his time, fires it downfield, and Jordan Giles is wide open. Not quite sure how he got that open. We'll take a look at a replay in just a moment, but look at that beautiful throw by Ben McLean. That's why he is starting over Ronnie Bell. One of the reasons why, at least, is the ability to make those throws. So you can see here, Jordan Giles cuts upfield, and the defender just loses track of him. He found himself wide open. If we could have thrown it to him in stride, we might have actually had a touchdown there, but Giles did have to dive to make the catch. So a quarterback keeper on a read option right here. Ben McLean picks up the first down later in the drive. That's going to set up a new first down and 10 inside the 20-yard line. Now it's a triple read option. McLean will hand this one off to Gerald House. House is going to end up finding his way into the end zone for the touchdown. We will extend our lead at this point, or retake the lead, I should say, 14-7. Gerald House, the now backup. Him and Travis Evans really split backup duties, but it is what it is at this point. It's really just a rotational running back system. You hear a studio update. 7-0 Boise State in upset alert right now to BYU, comes into this game 3-4. So we'll have to keep an eye on that as the day goes on. So back on the other end, here come the Yule Monroe Redhawks, I believe is their nickname. They run a nice little screenplay right there for a first down, 18 yards total on the play. Browning drops back out of the shotgun, scrambles all the way to the left. Peterson is tracking him, and Browning uses the entire side of the field and picks up 5 yards. An interesting route for Colton Browning to take, but he does pick up 5 yards now later in the drive, first and 10, and it's going to be a fire to the right side. Cook makes the catch. Bad awareness by our defensive back right there, and Tony Cook picks up 10 yards. Here's a first and 10. Browning drops back, feels the pressure, but finds Harper over the middle. Harper's got some daylight. He's going to get inside the 5-yard line before being brought down. That's going to be a 27-yard pickup for Colby Harper. And now here comes Colton Browning. It's going to be a handoff to Jairus Edwards. Edwards gets stopped. Great play by Stewart. That's going to set up a 4th and goal. And on 4th and goal, they're going to go for it right at the 1-yard line. It's a speed option, and Browning takes it into the end zone for the touchdown. So after what looks like could have been a great goal line stand for this Georgia State Panther defense, UL Monroe comes right into the end zone and scores a touchdown. So it's going to be all knotted up at 14 as we will take a look at the replay for Colton Browning finding his way into the end zone. So now that is going to be your score going into the half. Nothing else would happen outside of a Hail Mary interception from Ben McLean, but it is what it is. Nothing we can do about that. So we're going to go into the half with a 14-14 score. Even game from two, probably, at least record-wise, even opponents. So we'll see how that goes. Here running one of my favorite plays, the fake screen wheel route. Jordan Giles finds himself wide open. That's going to be a 31-yard pickup. Jordan Giles really stepping up as a deep threat for this team. He always finds himself open. He's a great route runner. Here we're going to find Albert Wilson, who makes a great diving catch for a 23-yard pickup. And the aerial attack from Georgia State is looking great right now. We're going to go back to the ground here. Ben McLean, dumb decision to keep it right there. Should have handed that one off. We're going to lose 3 yards on the play. That would set up a 2nd and 13. Now on the ensuing play, McLean will drop back, fire it over the middle to Danny Williams on the slant for a 9-yard pickup. They'll credit him with 10. That will set up 3rd and 4. Georgia State trying to keep the drive alive. It's going to be a little play action. McLean scrambles to his right, finds Gerald House right there. House will pick up 6 yards and the first down inside of the 10-yard line. Now on 3rd and goal, McLean is going to drop back once again, looking over the middle, and it's going to be caught by Jordan Giles. Giles' big day continues. He gets his first touchdown reception of the game, and Georgia State once again retakes the lead 21-14. McLean's first touchdown through the air, and Jordan Giles and his teammates are very excited after retaking the lead. But the defense will have to do its part and try to contain this lead. Colton Browning once again scrambling all the way to the left side of the field. This time he's going to be shoved out, picking up about 9 yards on the play. That would set up 2nd and 1. Now on 3rd and 3, Browning pitches it to Edwards. Edwards down the right sideline, lots of room, avoids a tackler, and he might go all the way. McClendon, though, takes a nice route to him, forces him out of bounds. That's going to be a 44-yard pickup for Jairus Edwards. Now Browning dropping back, finds over the middle to Steed, and Steed will pick up the 11-yard touchdown. So a quick drive from UL Monroe, and they tie the game right back up. Which defense will step up here and try to get the defensive stops necessary to stop the opposition's offense? That really looks like it's going to be what this game comes down to. So 21-all here later in the game, 3rd and 11. To the left side, that's going to be caught by Albert Wilson, the star senior wide receiver. 25 yards on the pickup. And now on 3rd and 8, McLean once again forced with a pressure situation here. He drops back, doesn't really find anyone open, scrambles a little bit. He's going to end up firing it. It's intercepted. Johnson on the interception right there. McClain's second interception of the game. First real one. I mean, that first one was just a Hail Mary one, but a costly turnover. Turnovers are, you know, biting us in the back, it seems, every game, so we're going to have to force a stop here. Browning on 3rd and 14 gives it to Edwards. Edwards is going to be forced out of bounds before he could pick up the first down. That would set up a 4th and 8, and UL Monroe would go ahead and punt the ball away, so we're going to get the ball back here. 1st and 10, little read option. Ben McClain on the keeper. He's going to pick up 7 yards. That would set up a 2nd and 3 chance to make up for that interception the last possession, but here comes Ben McClain looking. He's going to fire it over the middle. It's intercepted once again, this time by Edit. Edit is going to pick him off. Another costly turnover with just 4.5 minutes left in this game. This looks like it could come down to these type of turnovers. Really could just bite us in the back. So Browning drops back on 3rd and 6, finds Kevin Steed over the middle right there for a 12-yard pickup. That would set up a first down. Now Ewell Monroe once again driving. Browning scrambles to his left. He breaks the tackle. He's going to end up fumbling the ball, and it's recovered by Woodard. He will make up for Ben McClain's interception as we get the ball back. So here we go on 3rd and 10. Ben McClain, he gets another shot. How many more can he ask? We're fired, it's intercepted! Ben McClain is throwing this game away. The third interception of this quarter, all on this half of the field nonetheless. What a terrible disaster for this Georgia State offense. Here comes UL Monroe. Can they finally capitalize? They find May over the middle, and that's going to bring it inside of the 2-yard line. A 19-yard pickup for Tavarese Mee. May, wow, I can't mispronounce that name anymore. That's going to be incomplete, though. 4th and goal coming up for UL Monroe, and they're not going to take a risk here. They're going to bring out the field goal unit and take the 3-point lead. This kick is up, and it is good. So UL Monroe takes a 24-21 lead in what's turning out to be a thriller. Can Ben McClain hang on to the ball? First, we got a studio update, and it's that Boise State-BYU game. BYU is hanging around. It's 24-21. They are on top. Once again, Boise State on upset alert. 24-21. Here comes Ben McClain, still in the game. They have not pulled him for Ronnie Bell yet. We'll see if that is a move that comes later in the game. If not, next week. We'll see what happens. Ben McClain dropping back. 1st and 10. Fires to the left side. Danny Williams is there. That's going to be a first down, a 12-yard pickup. And we are looking to get into field goal range at least to try and tie this game. McClain, play action, dropping back. Firing it deep, and it is intercepted. Isaiah Newsom, the 4th interception of this quarter. What a disastrous, terrible, horrendous performance by Ben McClain. Now here comes UL Monroe. We only have 2 timeouts left. A first down here could seal it. Edwards is going to be brought down just before he gets to the first down marker. 3rd and 1. And this is the game right here, folks. A first down here wraps it up. And I accidentally do the stupid player lock thing, and they pick up the first down. I don't even know how I did that, but that is going to wrap up the game. We have no timeouts left. UL Monroe would kneel it from there. And we end up losing in just a colossal collapse. Oh, wow. What a bad performance by Ben McClain. Me, personally, I just felt the pressure at that point and tried to force too many passes. And you know what? It is what it is. I just got to work on that. And, you know, maybe we'll try to – I've been talking about the JUCO guys recently in, like, recent episodes. And maybe we'll have to go for a JUCO quarterback in next year's recruiting class. But – for now, we're going to have to, you know, ride it out with these guys and see where we can go from here. So anyway, that's pretty much going to wrap up this video. So I thank you guys for watching. Hope you did enjoy. This was Matt. Peace.